So stand to your feet now that you've got your Bibles. Raise them up to the Lord and let's go before the Lord in prayer and or whatever your device is. Just raise it to the Lord. Say, Father, we're coming to you in the name of Jesus. We're giving you all the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, that today we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man, nope. To hear from a woman, nope. To hear from a tall guy, a short guy, a brown guy, a black guy, a white guy. We don't do that, God. We've come into the house of God to hear from the teacher of the church who is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be and all that you would have us to do. And we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. And Lord, as you bless us this day with your presence, we would ask that you bless all the churches in the Inland Empire and around the planet that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels. Thank you for Emmanuel Baptist. Thank you for Trinity. Thank you for all of our brothers and sisters, our Catholic brothers and sisters, our Adventist brothers and sisters. At no way and at no time do we think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together in one field, building one kingdom, Lord. That's yours, and we give you all the praise and all the glory, and we're all in agreement with a great big shout. We say amen. Take your Bible out. Go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter, as we continue the study in the Word of God. In the word of the Lord, running the race. Remember how we started this off with Pastor Luke and then Pastor Dan. It's been absolutely wonderful. And just want you to know that this has been a great series. This is part number 6. So if you didn't catch the others, you can just hook on right where you're at. God will speak to you right where you're at. But you got to listen. You can't just daydream. You can't just wander off and wonder mentally why you didn't get anything from God. If you listen, God is going to speak to you, and the Holy Spirit's going to speak to you, and you're going to have a great encounter with the Lord. Running the race, part number 6. Let me just take a moment and review with you. In verse number 1 of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse 1 says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin in which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance. Everybody say the word endurance. One more time, could you say the word endurance? Endurance? Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Verse number 2, looking unto Jesus, author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Everybody say endured. Endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostilities. Everybody say endured. Endured. One more time. Everybody say endured. Endured. For consider him who endured such hostilities from sinners against himself, lest you become weary, discouraged in your souls. This is really about you. Sometimes when we come into church, it's about Jesus and how great he is, how wonderful he is, but you'll always find something in the Bible. He'll turn around who Jesus is and then make it as an example for you and I. And here we find that Jesus becomes our example as to what to do in order to endure those hardships and those times of trouble and those real times of character building, if you will, that are set before us. Here's an example of what I'm saying to you. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, verse number 2, who for the joy, there was a joy done something in his life. Looking at Jesus now, watch this, for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. In other words, the cross is a horrific expression, a horrific death, a horrific way to die, horrific torture, and he's going to endure this particular time of his life because there was something set before him. Where was it set? It had to be in his mind's eye. He had to be thinking of something. And did you know, as a man thinks, the Bible says, so is he? That in other words, your thinking has a lot to do with the outcome of where you're at and who you are, my friends. And so we find ourselves in a place where Jesus is enduring because of what was set before him or what he set his mind on in order that caused the joy that gave him the strength to endure the hardship that was facing him. Some of you are facing hardships in your life. Some of you have been in a battle for so long, you don't know how you're going to get out of it. You don't even see a way out of it. In fact, the battle that you're in doesn't even make sense. In fact, some of you are frustrated with God that he's allowed this battle to continue. And God's just waiting for you to catch a vision for your mind to be turned around, get into a position of joy, which is your strength, so that you can endure through this time and come out on the other side victoriously. The Bible makes it so clear for us over and over, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, though we walk through the valley, we don't camp in it, we don't stay in it, we don't sit in it, we don't complain in it, we're just going through this tough time, and I have to endure until I come out on the other side. Come on, somebody, and now Jesus becomes the example for us. I've often thought about what he set his mind on is probably different than what we humans would set our mind on. He probably had his mind set before him on heaven. Well, I don't know much about heaven. I can read about a little bit of it in the Bible. I can hear people's testimonies supposedly have gone there, and I believe they have and come back. But it's real hard for me to set my mind on heaven. I mean, he can set his mind and have it. He's going to be reunited with the Father. And all of a sudden, he is going to, what an excitement that must have been. But I haven't had that kind of a deep, personal, eternal relationship with the Father like Jesus did. So his thinking is different than my thinking. You know, if I use Jesus as an example, what was set before him that brought joy to help him endure the hardships that he's facing, then all of a sudden, I think one of the great things that had to be before him was the very fact that he was doing something wonderful. You know what it was? He was realizing that you and I were going to be on this planet. He knew that he was going to do something. He was going to, if you will, start it all over again under the blood of his sacrifice, redeeming mankind to the Father so that we could be brothers and sisters. We could be the bride of Christ headed for heaven and denying our presence in hell. Jesus was going to reset the whole garden experience. My goodness, that had to be an excitement. And it's just about over with Jesus. And he sets in his mind not the pain, not the problem, not the trial, not the scourging, not the belittling, not the people spitting upon him and yelling at him and screaming at him and the shame of what he's going through. He's not thinking about that. He's thinking about you and thinking about me, thinking about completing what the Father had. Oh my goodness, he is magnificent. And until we change our thinking, it's going to be hard for us to endure these times, and you'll want to quit. How important is endurance? That three times in three verses the word is used, endurance. And I had you shout it out each time. And I think it's in Matthew, the 13th chapter. I'm not sure, but I think it's in verse 19 of the 13th chapter of Matthew, where Jesus himself starts to explain about the sower and the seed. And he gives illustrations about four types of people. Three of the four types of people fail in endurance because they had their mind set on something else other than what they should have had their mind set on. They weren't strong enough to endure the problem. Let me say it again to you. They weren't strong enough to endure the problem. Let me say it one more time so you don't miss this. They weren't strong enough to endure the problem. How many of us have problems that are going to overcome us instead of us overcoming the problem? And here's the situation for all of us that are in here. You know, the problem can either get to you or you can get to the problem. The whole thing is that you can meditate the problem so much that you never see the solution, then the problem will overcome you. But God gives us an illustration, an example, if you will, and his name is Jesus. Notice verse number 3. In verse number 3 of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, let's pop it up on the overhead. For consider him. In other words, what he did is what we're supposed to do. For consider him who endured such hostility. Some of you are in the midst of hostility in your life right now with your kids, your family, your finances, your dream, your vision, your bosses, your everything, your neighbors. You know, the neighbor's dog that went and pooped on your front lawn every time you turn around. Some of you got real hostility going on over there. And here he does something. He endured because of what was set before him, the joy that his mind was fixed on. What is your mind fixed on? What's my mind fixed on in the middle of troubles and trials and problems? Are we trying to find a solution, trying to figure it out ourselves when the solution comes from Jesus Christ? And he says, consider him. So today there's a big question. And the big question for all of us is simply this. What should be set before us in a time to endure? In other words, there's a time you're going to need to have something set before you that brings the joy so that you can endure. Let me say it again. There's a time coming in every one of our lives that you're going to need to endure the situation that you're in. Keep in mind that 3/4 of the people that are introduced to Christ fail because they don't know how to endure. And now Jesus becomes our example on this particular Sunday morning as we follow the scripture. And as we follow the scripture, we learn how to endure in a simple way. I can't do it the way Jesus did because my mind is not fixed in that level of maturity, of understanding where Jesus is. But I can still do the principle of having my mind fixed on that which is going to bring joy in my life so that I can endure the hostility of hardships that are faced in every day of our life. Why? Because I want to keep on going. Why? Because the Bible makes it very clear. He that endures to the end, he that endures to the end. Didn't say endure for a little while. Watch this again. All of you in the back sections back there. He that endures to the end. Didn't say just endures for a little while. Didn't say just gets by. Didn't say just, you know, get a check from your aunt or your uncle and that solves the problem. He that endures to the end, the Bible makes very clear, watch this, shall be saved. Here's my question. What if you don't endure to the end? And you say, well, you know, grace will come in. I hope so. But in the meantime, I want to teach you because God said, consider Jesus so that you could have joys. Why? So that you can endure. Why we want to endure through that hardships to the end. Somebody say amen. Come on. And so here's some things that God gave me. I think they're pretty cool that I want to give to you. 4 simple, simple things. Why are they simple? Because I'm a simple person. I need to know simple and practical and easy things to do. I don't need to know the Greek and the theological understanding of stuff because I don't speak Hebrew, I don't speak Greek, and I don't need the theological understanding of it. I need to know how to do this, man. If I'm facing a hardship and I've got some horrific things coming down the line, I want to know how to stay in there and keep on fighting until I win the battle. Are you listening to me at all? So 4 simple things God gave me to give to you. Here's 1 on what we should set before us. The problem, you got to remember this, won't last. The problem isn't going to last. Sometimes we think the problem, we feel and act like it's going to last forever. You know what? I have a big word as an old man. Here I am in my 70s. And if you ask me one thing I could say to you about God, I would say, chill out. He's under control. He's a faithful God. Someone said to me, what's the most important thing? This is the other day, Debbie and I were both confronted by someone. I said, what's the most important thing you've learned in all the 40 years as a theologian? Here's what I learned. God's faithful and he's in control. Chill out. Yep. Have you ever been all uptight about something one day and the next day you're not so uptight about it and the third day you forgot all about it? It's like we let it just go crazy over something. Let me tell you something. Problems don't last. It's all going to be taken care of. And God, hello, is totally in control. And that's one of the hardest things for young people to learn. Is just take a deep breath, let some time pass or some water go underneath the bridge, and you will wake up one day and that problem won't even be a problem. You know, the Bible says, cast your cares on he that careth. So maybe the great thing to do with the problem is just say, God, it's not going to last. Just give it to you. Let him have it and stop taking it back. And how many times we have problems, we keep meditating the problem, meditating problem, meditating problem, meditating problem, till we try to get rid of the problem, and we never really get rid of the problem. We just tear ourselves up with tension. And so chill out, man. Realize the problem won't last. God's in control. He's going to take care of everything. Is anybody listening? I love the Word of God. While you're there, hold your place in Hebrews, but go with me to 1 Corinthians in the 10th chapter, verse number 13. The 10th chapter and verse number 13 says like this, no temptation, Paul writes these words. Could I ask you a favor? Could everybody say, no temptation?
No temptation.
That means pressure, hassle, trial, that means everything that puts a system in your way that causes you to be frustrated. Anybody ever been there? And he says, no temptation has overtaken you. Oh my goodness. Except such as common to man. Have you ever noticed when you're in a problem, you think it's like, this is the biggest problem in the world. You're the one that's doing it. And it's like, oh my goodness. And then it's not a big deal. Everybody's got problems. And everybody has, if you will, everybody not only has problems, your problems that you have are very common. I love those old words. Does anybody remember the old words, misery loves company? Well, it's kind of like you're miserable, but I want you to know you're not alone. Let's put it in those terms. Because here's what he says. He says, but God is what? Faithful. But God is what? Faithful. One more time. Well, just the back section. Nobody say anything in the front. You guys are way back there. Not letting you get asleep today. You don't get to sleep in this place, because if you fall asleep while I'm preaching, I'm old, but I'm tough. I'm coming back there. I'm going to smack you right in the face. So that back section back there, I want you just to yell out, God is what? He is
faithful.
Good for you. Okay, come on. Give me. Yeah. God is faithful. Who will not allow you? I mean, he's saying no. He says no. He says, I'm not allowing it to happen. Can you imagine God caring so much about you? He's not allowing it to happen. He says, will not allow you to be tempted beyond that which you are able. In other words, more. That's good. But I like the last part of this verse. Let's get the B up there, if you will. And he says, but with temptation, those are the problems that come, he will make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. If you know that, then you know the problem won't last. Somebody ought to say amen. The second thing that God gave me to give to you, and I love this, is Jesus is with you. Jesus is with you. My goodness sakes, Jesus with me, Jesus with you. It's a lot of times we forget in the middle of the problem, Jesus is there. It's not like you look the other way. Jesus is there with you. I remember when we were building this building, I had Jesus with us. We had a few thousand people in the church at that time, and we were in a building that was just too small, and we needed to grow, and we had gotten the approval from God to build a building. But the problem is, you can get an approval from God to build a building, but God, could you give me some money to build the building? I mean, like, you're saying, go ahead, do it, and I appreciate that, and I want to do it, but Lord, we don't have any money. We had to come up with like $20 million by the time we finished this building, and I mean, we were a church that we probably didn't have $500,000 in the bank in those days. We've been saving like crazy just to get $500,000, and here's a $20 million bill. And something kind of interesting takes place. Along with construction, my friends, comes timelines. Along with constructions come deadlines. There's a deadline to do something. There's a deadline to build something. And then I hate the third deadline. It's to pay for something. And the people that were building it didn't care about how spiritual I was or wasn't, you know, and that we were going to win souls or change lives. They could care less. They needed to be paid in order to, listen to this, go home and put tennis shoes on their children's feet. And rightfully so. And here we are, a church, like you see the campus as you see it today, is probably worth $40 million. But here we are today in this great building. Did you know that 2 months before the installation of the seats that you're sitting in, we had no idea where we were going to come up with $400,000 or $500,000 to pay for the seats. But it came. Well, I didn't know how we were going to pay the bill, but it did. I didn't know how it was going to work. It did. Because when Jesus is on your side, doesn't have to tell you anything more than that. And see, wait a minute. You missed that, didn't you? Because it's true. When Jesus is on your side, he doesn't say any more than that. He didn't say, hey, I'm on your side, and here's how it's going to happen. Da, 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 da. You know? No, he says, I'm on your side. That ought to be enough. And I absolutely, you know, never learned that because I was through the whole thing. We'd have meetings, didn't we, Mom? We had meetings on Friday that said on Monday you have to come up with $500,000. And I'm going, where are we going to get $500,000 on Monday to pay everybody? We sometimes had as many as 200 workers in one day on this campus, 200. And we'd say, oh, okay, God. I absolutely don't know where the money came out. I don't even know if we got the money. All I know is we're here. And nobody's mad at us. And somehow we paid our bills on time. And we walked in ethical and we were full of integrity. They just didn't know what was in my mind and my heart. What was in my mind and heart was Jesus is with us. Do I need to know more than Jesus is with me? Do you need to know how it's going to happen? Do you know when it's going to happen? Do you know where it's coming from? What do you need to know more than Jesus is with you? Is that not true? See, a lot of times we don't realize how important that is for us to see that he cares about us, he loves us, he feels for us, he's there with us. He understands the frailty of man. Hebrews, the fourth chapter, let me pop it up for you. Get your Bible, get this one, circle it. Hebrews, the fourth chapter, starting at verse 15. Let's put up verse 15, and it says this. For we do not have a high priest, speaking of Jesus. Remember, he says, we don't have a high priest. Who cannot sympathize with our weakness? Oh, thank God he sympathized. You know why? Because he's felt what we've felt. He's all man, all God. He cares about what we care. He knows what pressure's like. You know, there's one thing. Can I just say something? He understands man, but until he became a man, he never felt man. And now as a man, he felt you, felt me. That's why he's a great high priest who can represent us before the Father and say, wait a minute, Father, I understand what it's like being there. Then sympathize with you, but in all points tempted. I mean, wasn't he in all points tempted? We are yet without, tempted as we are, yet without sin. Verse 16. Let us therefore, because of what he just said, let it come boldly before the throne of what? Grace. What's grace? God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. Wait a minute. I just made a statement. Can you make the statement? Let me try it. Let's all say it together. Grace, God's sovereign divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. In other words, God gets in and kicks in when I can't do it. Man, that's good news. When I go as far as I can go. I do all I can do. But I'm here to tell you something. It's God who makes it work. And that's called grace. So I call on the throne of grace, his ability, that we may obtain mercy and find grace when? In a time of need. So here we are. Sometimes we forget, just as simple as this. Hey. 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 Back there. Jesus is with you. Do you need to know more than that? You don't know how you're going to make it financially. You don't know where you're going to get that job. You don't know how you're going to make it in your marriage. You don't know how the kids are going to get raised. You don't know how you're going to pay that bill. You don't know how it's going to happen. Let me tell you something. Welcome to the family of God that knows Jesus is all we need. Come on, somebody. Third thing, and I love this because this is kind of a cool thing. Third thing. In order for me to have joy, I have to remember some things in my life that God has done. So the third point here is remembering the victories of the past. Very important. Because under pressure, I can remember that it won't last, and that really helps me. And I can remember that Jesus is with me, and that's great. But then I need to think about how he comes through. And remembering the victories of the past helps Deborah and I in every area of our life. I was hoping they could find an archive picture of me. And I went fishing this one time. I told the story some years back. And we were in Montana. I just married Debbie. We had been married probably about 3 years. And we were in a meeting in Montana. And I was going to be introduced in that meeting that night. I was pastoring. I was going to be introduced. To me, it was a large meeting in Montana, but we had the whole afternoon off. And you may remember the story, may not remember the story, but it's something I remember all the time. I haven't forgotten because it helps me to endure, to remember things like this. And I remember saying, I just want to fish. I want to catch some fish. I'm up here. So we drove to a secluded, I'm talking dirt road, secluded up this mountain to a wild lake up there in the Montana mountains that you could hardly get to and hardly get out of. And we were up there by ourselves. There wasn't any boats on the lake. There wasn't any people in sight. We had a little place to park our little camper home. I don't know if it was a camper or what we were in, but we had a little place to do this. And we were just alone, you know. And there wasn't anybody in sight. And I told Mom, I said, you watch the kids back here. I gotta go try to find a place to fish. And I started walking up the shore of this lake. Never saw a person. There wasn't anybody around at all. There were certainly no boats, no rowboats. There were no people on those paddle boards. There was nothing, man. There was nobody out there. This was a secluded wilderness lake all by itself. There was no docks. There were no people. There was no campgrounds. There were nothing. But I just knew there were fish. And I started looking for a spot, and I had my fishing rod, and I walked along the lake, and I'm walking, not realizing this spot doesn't work, this spot doesn't work. 2 hours or 3 hours later, I end up on the other side of the lake, and I see something churling inside this little pond area. I mean, the water was like being spun around, like there was crocodiles or something in it, just all over the place. So I couldn't get to it with my fishing rod. So I jumped up on this big giant boulder, and in those days I could do it. I climbed up on the boulder and I looked down and I could not believe it. There were trout in this pond that were as long as my arm. I had never seen anything like that in my life. Oh my goodness, I still dream about it. I hooked up my bait as fast as I could. I threw it in. The first trout hit, bang, broke that line. In no time, it was too big. And I didn't know how I was going to get him up that rock anyway. So the second one, I caught. And it was an enormous trout. And I crawled down, holding the line, and crawled down the boulder to the falls side, got it to the little beach area, and I worked that trout until I knew better, because it was at least a 3-pound, 4-pound trout, and I knew it would do anything but break my line, so I worked him all the way to the shore. I couldn't imagine. I got him on shore, and he was worn out, and I grabbed him, and I held him up, and I said, oh, my goodness, look at this. And I'm so excited, and I start to walk back, and I realize I've got a 2-hour, 3-hour walk back with this big old trout. What am I going to do? And I'm supposed to be ministering tonight, or at least be introduced tonight at that meeting. And what am I going to do? How am I going to get back? And the meeting starts in an hour and a half. Then it's a long ways away. And I start to run with this trout. I'm running. And as I'm running, I'm sweating. I get the sweat coming down over my eyes. I've got this trout, and I see something in the distance across from the lake. And whatever it is, it's speeding. And it's coming faster and faster. As it gets closer, it is a power boat with one of those big engines with those, you know, those muffler pipes sticking straight up in the air, all chrome. And the guy's coming across the lake, and he comes right up to me, and he looks at me and he says, "You need a ride?" I said, "Yes, I need a ride." This true story. I climb into the boat, and he guns the sucker. I told him, "I'm over there." I didn't even know he knew where he was. This is a true story. He's going so fast across the lake, I can't see anything. I can't see him. The old tears are coming out of my eyes. I'm holding on to my fish with dear life. And I got to tell you the truth. Here's what happened. I look at him, and I'm thinking, this has got to be an angel. And then I saw him, man. He looked like he was a mugger on the street, and he was drinking a beer. He couldn't be an angel. I'm telling you, they disguise themselves very well. That's why the Bible says you don't know who you're entertaining. It might be an angel. Well, I figured it couldn't be an angel. He has a beer in his hand. My goodness, can I tell you something? He drops me off right there where Debbie is. And I have this one picture of Jessica. She's this big, Pastor Jessica. She's this big. Luke wasn't even born. I'm holding up the trout like this, that picture of me. We got back in our car. We drove back and made the meeting on time. Right. What am I saying? I have to remember things like that, that God would provide for me during that period of time. You need to remember things too. Listen to what it says in Hebrews 10th chapter, verse number 32. Are you ready? In verse number 32, I love this. "But recall the former days in which, after you were illuminated," you know, that's what God tells the children of Israel. Tell your children constantly. You guys in back, listen to me. Tell your children about Jesus constantly. It's not only good for you, but it's good for them to hear it over and over and over again. Don't forget. We humans have a tendency to forget. And we have a tendency to treat God in heaven like he's a dog on a leash. Do a new trick for me today because I forgot yesterday's trick. Can I tell you something? Don't treat God that way. Start remembering the great things that he's done for you and in your past. He came and he redeemed you. He washed you. He set you free. He set you on the road, on the right path, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell. He is worthy of us remembering who he is. Number four that God gave me to give to you, running the race. What do I need to set my mind upon in order to have the joy to endure these hardship times that are set before me is like the craziest of them all. When God gave me this, it was just so much fun. Number four is this: understand your weakness. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. Only in a mature church will you hear these words. Your weakness is the door to God's power. And God is just looking for someone who comes to the end of their rope. And you might say today, "Pastor, I'm at the end of my rope. I don't know how I'm going to make this. I really can't do it." Can I say something? You're the perfect candidate for the power of God to come along and help you to get the job done, because it is the very door to his power is in your admitted weakness. God's not looking for somebody powerful. You know, the Bible itself says, "I can do all things through Christ." Doesn't stop there. It says, "I can do all things through Christ Jesus." I can do all things through who? Him, not me. And if you think you can do it yourself, it ain't going to work, and you will get exhausted. And you've got to remember that being weak and not being able to do it, that's when God kicks in and he does it. In fact, listen to what Paul, who writes the New Testament, two-thirds of the New Testament, and he writes this in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. And in verse number 10, after he talks to God three times about removing a problem, and God says, hey, my grace is sufficient. I'm not getting you out of the problem. I'll get you through the problem. And he says, therefore, I take pleasure in my infirmities. You see the word infirmities? If you have it in your Bible, you could just write the word weakness in there. That's where a better translation for it. It's not sick. But even if you were sick, that would apply. He says, I take pleasure in my infirmities and reproaches and needs, in persecution and distress for Christ's sake. For when I'm weak, stop trying to be all tough. Stop trying to get up in God's face and show him how tough you are. Because here's the great man of God says, and when I'm weak, then he comes along, he says, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Because God comes into this. Now let me just show you one more verse, if I may. I think one of the most powerful verses in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. When I mention to any crowd in America or upon the planet, and I say that Hebrews, the 11th chapter, is noted for one thing, a lot of people will yell one word. Do you know what that word is? Hebrews, the 11th chapter, is noted for what word?
Faith.
Everybody says the same thing. The hall of faith. But the most important five or six words found in Hebrews is not the word faith. Is not the word faith in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. The 11th chapter, verse number 34, listen to the words. Out of weakness were made strong. Abraham, Isaac, Sarah, Moses, and all the others that are mentioned in Hebrews, Hall of Faith, out of their weakness, they were made strong. When you're facing a problem and a trial, you're going to feel weak. And you are the perfect candidate for his power to come. He's not looking for someone to be strong. He's looking for someone to be dependent. In your dependency on him comes the strength of God to get through the problem. Today, four things that we need to set before us that are very important. One, the problem won't last. Two, Jesus is with us. Three, remember the victories of the past. And four, you need to understand your weakness is not a bad thing, but it's actually the doorway to the power of God. If God spoke to you today, come on, give the Lord great big praise. Isn't that good? Simple, simple. Simple stuff, you know? But I need to be reminded. Yesterday someone came to me and said, Pastor, I needed to be reminded of that. We all need to be reminded. That's why we come to church. We need to be reminded of these things so that we keep on keeping on doing what God has until the promise comes to pass. One more time, if God spoke to you today, give him a great big praise the Lord. Woo! Good to be with you in the house of the Lord. Real quick, now I want to talk to all of you in the back section just for a moment. One more time, back section. Hear me, back section. Everybody back there? There's no getting up right now. Church is not over. Did you know that when you leave early, man, I know you may have to go pee. Anybody has to go pee, it's my age people go pee. And not your age. So just cross your legs and sit there. I'll let you go in just a moment. And don't get up because we're going to judo chop you if you do. It's that simple. Going to... Yeah, these ushers are trained to judo chop people who leave early. So sit still, because when you get up, here's the problem. 20 people follow you or sheep. And then they wonder what happened. Last week, I'm out there in the foyer getting people saved because they left early and they needed to get saved. So today is your time of getting right with God. So come on, let's talk just for a moment. Before you leave this place, check yourself out. You know, the Bible says it like this, that you need to, from time to time, examine yourself. And it's okay. To make sure, here's what the Bible says, to make sure you're right with God. I need to examine myself from time to time. Am I still fired up? Am I still excited? Am I still going for God? Is He my passion? Is He my heartbeat? Am I right with God? Some of you need to examine yourself. So I want to ask you a question. You can answer it in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Is that okay? But at least don't just stare at me. Answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know. Here's the question. If you were to walk out to your car and your heart stopped, bang, and you died, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Come on, listen to me now. That's the question. If you died in the next few minutes, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Answer the question. Now let's talk about your answer, because your answer says a lot about where you're at. Some of you said it like this. Here's your answer. Well, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I think I'm going to make it. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible, nowhere, it's not in the Bible, that says you can be a positive thinker and get to heaven. You're not going to make it, and somebody needs to tell you. Some of you had this answer. Well, I hope that if I died in the next few minutes, I hope I'd make it. Can I tell you something? Nowhere it says whoever hopes the most gets to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you. Some of you think, well, I'm really a pretty good person. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm good. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to go to heaven because you're good. You're not going to make it. It's not in the Bible. You're not going to make it. Someone needs to tell you. You can't think of yourself as being good and get to heaven. Some of you said, well, wait a minute. I'm going to go to heaven because my mom and dad told me I was a Christian when I was a kid. They took me to catechism class and Sunday school class, Sabbath school, put a cross, St. Christopher, around my neck. That means I'm a Christian. I get to go to heaven, doesn't it? My mom and dad had me christened or baptized when I was a baby. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible says your mom and dad can tell you a Christian, get you christened or baptized when you're a baby, put a cross or a St. Christopher around your neck, makes you a Christian. Nowhere. Nowhere, 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 not in the Bible. And if you think that's going to get you to heaven, you need to stop and think and hear what I'm going to say. You're not going to make it. Jesus said these words. Watch these words. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That's what Jesus said. You can't get there my way, some well-meaning church committee way, or any other way. You have to get there His way. And He tells us, oh, listen to me now. Listen. He tells us exactly how to get to heaven in the Bible. He tells us. In John 3rd chapter, He says these words. You must, listen to this. You must be born again. You're not going to make it any other way. And as soon as I use the words born again, a lot of American churches just immediately turn off. Born again people are idiots and radicals and fanatics. And I'm not going to associate with somebody that's born again. They're crazy. Can I tell you something? Please hear what I'm saying to you. He's not talking about that type of a person. Born again means something different. It means this, and I'll tell you from the beginning of the Bible, the end of the Bible, here's what born again means. Listen closely to what I'm saying to you. It's important that you hear this. Here's what born again means. It means you have given God, listen to me now, you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It is an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. And somebody needs to love you enough. Listen, you upper level. Somebody needs to love you enough to tell you the truth. You must be born again. That means you've got to give God all of your heart. You've got to give God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. I'll prove it to you. All or nothing, Pastor? All or nothing. Book of Revelation. Jesus Himself is speaking. Watch these words. And He says, I'm coming again. And when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness, what a rude, crude statement. I'll vomit you from my mouth? I thought Jesus was sweet, kind, and wonderful. Man, he's up in your face with that comment because it's serious. You can't be lukewarm and get to heaven. You're going to be ejected from the body of Christ, and you're not going to make it. So let's define lukewarm. Little in, little out, that's lukewarm. Little up, little down, that's lukewarm. You know, occasional church attendance, that's lukewarm. Not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God, that's lukewarm. You believe that Jesus is the Son of God, but you really don't give a big flip one way or the other. You're more into yourself than you are him or anything that has to do with him. That's lukewarm, my friend. And today, God loves you enough to tell you the truth and brought you here because it's a divine appointment for you to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Let me tell you something. You can go to seminary school for 8 years, come out with a doctorate's degree in theology, die and go to hell if you're not born again. And today, in this safe and friendly place, we've laughed, we've had a good time. You were listening to the Word of God. You were great in this place. Today, let's get right with God all across this auditorium. You say, well, Pastor, how do I do it? Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. I'm going to count to three in a moment. I'll go like this. One, two, three. And I'll pop my hands. Bang! When you hear that sound, bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. And what you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. And I want you to pray with me. And I will do just that. And if you want to be included in that prayer, today is your day of salvation. Now, here's how it's going to work. Every head bowed and every eye closed. So nobody's looking. This is a private time with you and God. Stop looking at me. Stop opening your eyes. Stop it. I see all of you looking at me. Are you listening at all? Close your eyes. Bow your heads. Up. You're still not doing it. Close your eyes. Bow your heads. Time of privacy. This is a time in a moment when I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. Who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're just not sure if you have or not, my goodness, make sure. Today is your day. Every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody moving around. Nobody's looking but you in your heart and God. And if you want to be included in that prayer to go to heaven instead of going to hell, and be born again, then in a moment when I pop my hands together, you get your hand up. Let me see it. Just hold it up for a moment. Nobody's looking, so nobody will know. Every head's bowed. I'm making sure of that. And then you can put it back down. When I tell you, you can put it down. I'm counting to three. Here it is. One. In the family rooms, I'm talking to you also. Two, three. Let me see your hands. There's one, there's two, three, four, five. Thank you. There's six, seven, eight. Thank you. There's 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Thank you. God bless you. Back over this side. Keep them up. 20, 21, 22. Thank you. Back here. 23. Thank you. God bless you. In the family room, 24. I got you. Back over here, 25. I got you guys already back over there. There's 25 people already. Anybody else? Go ahead. You can put your hands down. I saw you already. Go ahead. Put your hands down. Anybody that didn't get their hand up, but you know you should have. You know who you are. You're saying to yourself, I should have done that. Nobody to embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Last chance. Get your hand up in this safe, friendly place today. Anybody else that needs to pop their hand up? I'm just going to go across this audience one more time. Don't miss this. Anybody else? There's 25. Anybody else? There's 26. God bless you. Anybody else? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 26 wise people. Okay. And God good. Now, here's what we want to do. 26 wise people from the family room, bring your children. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff, okay? Look, you said you want to be included in that prayer. I want you to know something. I want you to walk the safe and friendly aisles of a church for Jesus. If Jesus can walk a beaten, bloody mess for you, as they spit at him on his way to the cross while they put shame on him, carried your shame and your sin, you can get out of your seat in a safe and friendly place. If you raised your hand, and or you should have raised your hand, I want you to, if you need to, get a hold of your friend, just nudge your neighbor and say, come on, go with me. Listen, I want you to get out of your seat, get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. Let's stand and welcome them as they come. You come now, no one leave. You come now, no one leave. You come now. Come, 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 come. Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, no one leave. You come now. Come on. Come on home. Come on home. Come on, give them a hand as they come. Come on home. They're still coming. Give them a hold. Give them a hand as they come. Come on, one more round of applause. You can come too. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming so much. Thanks for listening to the Word of God. I tell you, I love you. I just want to tell you the truth. I'm too old to mess with people. I just say it like it is. I offend half of everybody, but I'm telling you the truth. This is nothing to mess with. This is a time to get right with God by giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life. I want to point out something. I want you to watch me now. Look up here. Number one point, put a smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. You're not going to the morgue. You're going to heaven. I mean, good. This is a good thing, you know? So watch this. Okay, now look at me for a second. See this guy over here? This is Reverend Tony. He's waving at you. He's a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on. He's just going to lead you in a prayer and give you some free stuff. The F word here at The Rock is free. We love free stuff. He's going to give you some free stuff to tell you what to do next. It's a little booklet that I wrote. It's like a third grade reading level, so it's cool. You can understand it. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to make a left turn, everybody. And the people you came with, they'll wait for you. Only takes a moment. I want you to go right over there with Pastor Antonio. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Isn't God good?